Welcome to All Things Financial with Jack Driscoll. Each week, Jack takes on all things you thought were hard to understand about your finances and makes it fun, easy, but most of all, interesting. From insurance to the best way to save your money and squeeze the most out of the dollars you put aside for your rainy day. And now, you have a friend in the money business. Here's your host, Jack Driscoll.
Welcome back again, everyone, to another edition of All Things Financial. We have with us a special guest, a specialist in life insurance planning and estate planning, Ian George. I thank you for coming back on the show.
My pleasure.
What we're doing here are discussing some advanced concepts with life insurance in uses that you might not otherwise see uses for or some of the benefits. In today's show, I wanted to focus on some outlying areas. You know, in many cases, we don't talk to you business owners enough. And this is a prime opportunity because most business owners have highly complex needs. They're very complicated, and usually there's a multiple of needs we have as business owners on a daily basis and in a future planning basis. You know, we don't have a company taking care of us if we're business owners. The 401k is us providing the 401k plans for the employees. Where's our retirement plan? Is it the value in our business? What is the value in our business? Is it based on how long can we work? When do we want to retire? Our own asset plans, our own legacy plans, in fact, our own survival right now, what should happen to our business if we don't wake up tomorrow? So a lot of these issues I wanted to talk about on today's show. Ian, thanks again for coming back on the show. And if you can, share with us some strategies that you've used to help some business owners, for example.
My pleasure. Okay, so when we're talking about, now we're back to talking about life insurance. So That's why I'm here. And where that comes into play for business owners. Most business owners, when they take a look at what they're doing, have at a very minimum what would be considered a key man or key person policy. Basically, what that's designed to do is I have the business owner and the world kind of reflects around that business owner. This is obviously talking about smaller businesses where the business owner wears probably a number of different hats. Simply put, if something were to happen to that business owner, there would be large problems with that business. It may just absolutely cease to exist. Okay. Is how reliant a lot of small businesses are on their business owner. So business owners, generally speaking, are conscientious individuals who have a great deal of respect and caring for the individuals and families that rely on their business. Not just their customers, but most importantly, their employees. And oftentimes you can have multiple generations within that business too, but we'll get into how that structure works. So the idea behind key person life insurance in that particular area is if something were to happen to that business owner prematurely, money is going to come in from the life insurance policy to help that business resolve itself. Now that may be that it's helping that business to continue on. So the ability to hire somebody to replace that business owner in a couple of the capacities. So for example, a lot of small business owners are their number one or their business's number one salesperson. So, that money could be used to help hire a salesperson to keep that driving while the rest of the business is getting its feet back underneath it. So that's basically a key man policy. What we often see more often than not in small businesses are partners. Could be, two guys in a, or two women, or multiple individuals that own that, two, three, four, five, that are all owning it and into business. One of the things that I have started to see actually are two couples going into business, where you have a husband and wife with another husband and wife, and they've gotten together to start a business. So that's a complicated situation too, as you can well imagine, in terms of what goes on. But let's just leave it at multiple individuals. Well, what you have to look at there is a buy-sell agreement in terms of what's going on that front. So a buy-sell agreement is pretty straightforward. So, Jack, if you and I were, you know, in business together and, you know, we each owned half, to keep it simple. And very often you don't have people that it's, you know, cut in half.
Okay.
But I find all examples are more easily understood if we make it extremely simple.
I agree.
Excuse me. So if you have two partners that are 50-50 owner, obviously the concept is if something were to happen to one of us, our family, the deceased family is going to say, hey, what do we, you know, we now own half the business and we have no interest in it. So for example, if you and I were in business and something were to happen to me, you may not want to be in business with my wife.
Right.
Odds are pretty good my wife doesn't want to be involved in the business with you. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, she probably would have been involved in the business from the get-go, right?
Right.
So it's probably not her interest or her understanding or anything along those lines. So how does my wife get fairly compensated for half of the business at the time? Well, without the life insurance in play, the surviving partner is going to have to come up with money, and that could be tough. That could be, it could be a huge drain on the business. It can often, and I've seen this before, it can often involve getting a loan from a bank. And if it gets nasty, which it can happen too, which means my, you know, the surviving spouse, so my wife in our example now comes up and says, you're not playing the way I want to play. She starts talking to the competitors about the ability that she has, and she now has the ticket for half your business. And she's taking that to the street for the competitors.
God.
And that can be an awful position to be in.
So you end up maybe being in partner with a competitor if they buy out her share?
Not only could you be in partnership with a competitor, but you might get a partner you don't want, and his whole plan is to put you out.
Ouch.
So that can absolutely happen.
Okay.
So now the key goes back to, let's circle back quickly before I get into where the life insurance play can come into here. The key to a lot of this is making sure you do have a buy-sell agreement. Because buy-sell agreements are important. You and I talked a long time ago about the fact that when we invest in something, the first thing we have to know before we go in is how do we get out.
Right.
So true with businesses. Do a lot of work with small business owners day in and day out. And I will tell you, when I sit down with a business venture and there's no buy-sell agreement in place, I say we can't do much work until you start getting work on that.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have to understand what the exit strategy is. Because one day somebody could wake up and say, I just don't want to do this anymore. Nobody needs to die for this to happen, by the way.
Okay.
This could be just, hey, I'm done. I don't want to do this anymore. You don't want the business to go out, but I don't want to do this anymore. What's the relationship and how's that going to be structured?
Okay.
That often is going to be structured differently in a living situation than it would if one of us were deceased. But your attorney can help you walk through all the different buy-sell, you know, areas that come up.
Okay.
And I am going to put one tag in here before I get into a strategy that we can use to make the, you know, get a little bit more out of that buy-sell life insurance policy. The tag I'm going to put in is, so many small businesses that I go to and sit down with have addressed the event of, if we're living, look, you're going to buy me out over 10 years, we'll reach a structured payment, we'll find out a valuation, that's all done and done beautifully. It's also a simple fix, is if one of us dies, they have life insurance in place, the life insurance is going to pay the other off, which means, you know, if I die, you own a policy on me, which gives you the cash to give to my spouse, she's out on a fair settlement, you now have 100% of the company.
Right.
What they don't address for is if I become disabled. If I'm disabled and unable to pull my weight in that company or do anything with that company, I still own half of it, and now I'm a drag on that company. So many small businesses refuse to address the problems of disability. And you can guess which a higher risk is, the odds of becoming disabled or dying.
Yeah.
Please make sure in your disability, in your buy-sell agreement, that you've addressed disability. Because nothing worse than you having to look at me while I'm disabled and say, we have to arrange a selling agreement.
Yeah.
And I need money now because I'm disabled and things have gone wrong. So that's just my quick plug to make sure people have addressed that as well. So where can we get advantages? So a lot of buy-sell agreements and key person policies are funded or backed up with term life insurance policies, where I pay my premium, it's just term life if something happens. A lot of this can be done out of necessity, primarily because where you could be a new business and cash flow is slim, we still need the protection, not unlike, you know, term life insurance for a young family. But there are opportunities that can be had in using permanent life insurance. And the permanent life insurance can come from the fact that if we choose to, we could have the life insurance policy be owned by our entity. Now, different attorneys have different ways. When you have two partners, there's one way of having a buy-sell agreement. It's called cross-purchase, which I buy one on you, a policy on you. I buy and own, and I'm the beneficiary in a policy on you. You buy and own are the beneficiary of a policy on me. That can create a lot of simplicity should something happen.
Okay.
Now, the other form of buy-sell is entity-owned and becomes more and more popular when you have multiple partners. So you can imagine if there were five of us involved in a business and we were each doing buy-sells back and forth on all those different contracts, mm-hmm. I can tell you as somebody who's done those contracts and has been in those meetings, when someone came up with the idea of cross-purchase with five people, I said it won't happen. Because yeah. That's 25 contracts.
Yeah, that's nice.
And that's a lot for companies to track and what they're going to do. Yeah. So you end up with the entity owned. Our business is going to own the policies on you and I. Well, here's the advantage. The advantage of doing that is, one, the cash that's within those permanent life insurance policies, the cash stays on the books of the company. So over time, as we're funding these policies, mm-hmm. that cash is on the books. And as you know, with most properly structured permanent life insurance policies, that cash is liquid. I have access to that cash. Okay. Our company can use that cash should it need to. Generally speaking, when you're setting these up, you want it to be the last stop for the company to use as cash.
Okay.
And a lot of companies do keep, you know, the emergency reserves. And that's where this would qualify, would be your emergency reserve of cash. Mm-hmm. But the advantage to this can be great because over time, the difference is the premiums that I paid for my life insurance policy is going to be offset a bit by the cash value that's growing. So over 10 years or so, if I looked at what I spent on a term life insurance policy, it's going to be a pretty big number and there's no cash to it. It's a pure risk policy. While conversely, in the using a permanent life insurance policy, over say, if I use the calculation of taking a look at it at 10 years or 12 years or something along those lines, I take a look at it and say, hey, I paid this in there.
Right.
For my death benefit, and guess what? I have on or about what I paid in there in the cash on the company's books. So for the company, the operating expense to make sure that that risk was protected, the actual net cost has been lower. Mm-hmm. The other nice side effect of that is, going back to that buy-sell agreement, that permanent policy was making sure that if something happened, you would have the money to buy my family out, or I would have the money to buy your family out.
Right.
Well, now let's say it's just time. We've decided it's time for us to go. Let's start with a simple example of I decided that I'm going to leave. I've been doing our business for a number of years and decided that I'd like to retire. Well, for the part of the structure to the buyout, the company's going to look at it and say, you owe, you know, For my buyout, the agreed upon price will be X. We've had it all drawn up. We know how this is going to work in advance. So there's no great shock and no great hand-wringing as to how this is going to work.
Okay.
So I'm just ready to start it. But sitting in there is a cash-valued permanent life insurance policy. Well, the first payment that might be coming my way for buyout of that would be that permanent life insurance policy.
Okay.
So, hypothetically speaking, just pulling a number out of thin air, the company we've grown is worth $2 million, so the buyout's going to be, you know, $1 million. The agreed-upon settlement has been it's going to be taken care of over, let's say, 5 years, so that's $200,000 a year.
Yeah.
And let's say that the life insurance policy has $100,000 in it. There's $100,000 of the first year, and then another $100,000 in cash, and then the $200,000 there. has been coming out. What's the advantage to you and I on that? Well, the advantage to the individuals who are involved in that company who receive that as payment is that, one, you are going to probably have to pay taxes on the cash value that was sitting in that policy. Is that an advantage? Not particularly. Is it a disadvantage? Not really, because anything coming out of the company as payment for exit strategy or for shares of the company is going to be taxed anyway. The inherent value here, though, is with a life insurance contract, I can take and pay my taxes out of that contract. And if I set that thing over to the side and look back over it in a couple of years, it's probably started to grow back significantly.
Okay.
So I've got that. Not to mention the fact is that I've got death benefit. Right. That I've left with. The death benefit I've left with can be leveraged in my overall plan as an individual. So I'm leaving the company with my payment, and as part of that payment, I have my death benefit. This means that I know that while my wife and I are enjoying retirement, that upon my death, the pot is going to be refilled with that death benefit to come back in.
I see.
Okay. Let me add another caveat to it. Because this is all about options. Mm-hmm. I have an IRA, like we talked about in the last episode. I took my money out of that policy to pay my taxes that were due on the distributions that I received for my buyout.
Right.
I now have a hole in that whole life policy or UL policy. Mm-hmm. I now have room in there because I took money out. Guess what I can fill it with? I can take money from the IRA, pay the taxes on that, and it's the same strategy just into an existing policy to put it back into that nice bucket in there that's protected.
And refill it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that's where those options start to come in. And what's nice about this is all along, I'm using, you know, my premiums for a permanent life insurance policy are going to be 10 times that of what they'd be for my term life policy. Mm-hmm. The difference is that cash isn't just going away. That cash is going in to the book, sitting on the book of my business.
So it turns those monies into an asset of the company,
mm-hmm.
rather than an expense to the company, which is term insurance. Even though the term insurance premiums are so much lower, they end at some point typically, and they're pure expense. They're 100% an expense with no residual asset capability later.
So what the other nice thing to know is that the insurance companies have thought about this. So there are a number of insurance carriers that have structured policies where basically what happens is in the first year of paying my premiums that I am guaranteed that anywhere between, say, depending upon the carrier, 85 to 90% of my premium is going to be in my cash value.
Okay.
So if my premium that I was looking at was $1,000 for my term life policy for our buy-sell agreement.
Okay.
And the contract that somebody brought to me to do that in the permanent strategy was $10,000. Well, now you're taking a little different situation. So if I pay the $10,000 for that life insurance policy as opposed to the $1,000 term policy,
right.
I have sitting in the company's books that $10,000 anywhere from $8,500 to $9,000 in cash value.
Okay.
Now, if I, year over year, you can imagine I've been paying that term life insurance policy that's just a bill. That's money going out. Well, within a few years of those types of structured policies, I'm not paying for the term life insurance anymore. If I look at how much I put in, it's actually greater in that bucket than the amount that I paid in.
I see.
So I'm a little bit ahead of the game on the deal. So the cost of it has now become part of what I'm, you know, is my bank within my company.
Okay.
So there are policies that have been specifically structured for business owners in these situations.
Okay.
The other aspect too is this translates to not only the buy-sell agreements, but this can also be used for the key person agreement. So for example, if you have not just you, but let's say you do have an employee who's very important to you. Could be a top salesperson, it could be a vice president of your company that's doing something. And you want to make sure, because when you go to bed at night and you think about if something happened to that person, how damaging it would be to your company.
Yeah.
You might want to sit there and have a conversation with them about having a key person life insurance policy put on them. Well, as part as a quid pro quo on that, if you can imagine if I come to you and say, Jack, I want to insure your life because if something happened to you, my business would be hurt. Mm-hmm. And you say, if something happened to me, my family would be hurt. So part of that discussion might come into not only getting a key person policy for you, but structuring something for your family as well. Okay. So they get a little bit of extra something along those lines too. Let's say that we're pretty sure that you probably won't die in the saddle while working. Mm-hmm. You might like to have an executive bonus plan associated with that too. Well, again, that's that cash value in that policy being able to carry its weight and do a lot of things, and you don't have to die to enjoy it. And I don't need you to die for it to work.
So you're using one of the immediate needs, which is premature death or disability or whatever the problems are, key man, that we see ourselves vulnerable on as a business due to health or premature death. And then what you're doing is you're converting that solution, utilizing a resource that can be tapped in later years should that catastrophic inevitable event never happen. You can go back in and have it apply for other source, other purposes, right?
Correct. And the whole idea of any type of plan that's properly built by an advisor using permanent life insurance, the whole plan is to add options, to create more choice, to create more efficiency in what we all work with. So that's the whole idea behind everything. It's what am I doing in this situation that could be done more efficiently? And in the examples that I've brought to the table, you know, today and in past, has been where permanent life insurance can come up is it can provide a whole lot of nice side benefits along with the death protection, the living benefits and things like that that go along, all choices.
Okay.
What I often say about permanent life insurance policies is generally speaking, what you'll find about the contracts is that they're very simple. Where people start to get blown away is when they start to take a look at all the different things you could do with it.
Yeah.
Because your choices are rather unlimited. It's just how you're going to use the tax advantages of everything that's built into them.
I have heard life insurance for business owners referred to as double duty dollars, where you're saying, I'm trying to solve a potential of multiple needs. I don't know which one I will have. I know I might have a couple of them. Either dying prematurely or living later and needing assets to help in retirement or whatever. And that was referred to as double duty dollars. So I see where they came up with that.
Yep.
All right, Ian, I appreciate your coming back again on the show.
My pleasure.
Folks, I hope you appreciate some of the discussions that we're having here. It's why I call the show All Things Financial. We'll be back again next week. And thanks again, Ian, for joining us.
My pleasure.
Securities and investment advisory services offered through Sage Point Financial Inc., member FINRA, SIPC, and registered investment advisor. Insurance services offered through Driscoll Insurance and Financial Services Inc., which is not affiliated with Sage Point Financial Inc.